curses, both in the utopias of Edward Bellamy and others, and in the juvenile adventure serials. After the World Wars, it flooded and overwhelmed almost all the other national traditions, though some of them resisted, either by censorship, as in the USSR after 1928, or by keeping popular science fiction in dialogue with a tenuous but real high lit or philosophical science fiction, for example, in the United Kingdom, Stapleton, Huxley, Orwell, and others. Some light on who are the readers of US science fiction has been shed both by sociological research and some theoretical speculations, though they are still initial and narrow. To begin with, nobody except perhaps some jealously secretive publishers of books and magazines has even estimated the readership size. How many readers of science fiction? I'm speaking here about the heyday of science fiction, 60s, 70s, okay? Were there 100,000, millions? Nobody knows. This is a macro datum that nobody knows except publishers who lock it up, you know. Nonetheless, the profile of US readers seems exemplary for European and Japanese readers too, and there is practically no mass circulation of science fiction literature, which is all I'm talking about. I'm not talking about comics and movies and so on, in the south of our planet, okay? South America, Africa, South Asia, and so on. Therefore, I shall discuss the US readers as a typical population in a Lukacian sense, where it implies the latent historical tendency. Science fiction fans, as you all know, constitute a veritable subculture with a flourishing communication network of innumerable fan magazines, yearly conferences in permanent dialogue with, and serious influence on the science fiction editors and writers. Between 1949 and 74, at least a self-selected, more active core of fandom present at conferences, which could be therefore polled, presented the following parameters. Its reading began at age 8 to 13. It was predominantly young, with 40 to 60% being up to age 24 and only about 15% over age 40. It shifted between these dates, up to 74, from more strictly scientific professional orientation to a majority oriented towards social sciences and humanities, so that straight science in 74 accounted for only about 15% of the fans. It was predominantly male, though the proportion of female readers rose after the 60s from one-tenth to about one-third, parallel to its professional and ideological shift, as well as to the emergence of first-class female science fiction writers. It is in its majority urban, the fans, living in cities over 250,000 inhabitants. The average number of books or magazines read was 7 per month, which is high even in the USA, huh? Especially in the TV age. A major part of adult science fiction readers had an appreciably higher university level education and a much higher income, about 2 or 3 times, than the average white individual in the USA. Furthermore, rightly or wrongly, this major part considered then, themselves, in the 60s and early 70s, upwardly mobile, and having a high degree of say in their jobs. Obversely, though we have no ethnic statistics, it is clear that manual workers, black and other ethnic minorities, the rural population, and to a decreasing extent women, were seriously underrepresented in US science fiction readership. Hypotheses such as Gerard Klein's take into account mainly the ideal reader inscribed in the best science fiction itself, and reach the conclusion that the hegemonic social fraction towards which science fiction is as a rule addressed, and whose destinies are this genre's horizons, is, and I quote Klein, the scientifically and technologically oriented middle class. That's to say, not the upper rich class, which is only in finance, not the workers, peasants, blah, blah, blah. Okay. However, the fragmentary basis of the data available requires much more systematic work. But also it requires, I believe, inner differentiations between, say, omnivorous and active fans versus occasional readers. Most important, there are the various ideological wings, ranging from feminists and left utopians to high officers of the US armed forces and a subgroup of mercenary science fiction. Okay, in other words, extolling the exploits of mercenaries on other planets, killing lots of people with high technology and so on. There seem then to be three main and overlapping literate US groups that do not read science fiction. The passive, called usually couch potatoes, the traditional anti-technological humanists, and the supporters of the momentary political-ideological status quo, who don't want to read about other worlds because they are happy in this one, clearly. A better definition of the social bearer of science fiction would have to say that it is a cluster of class fractions. I've had these debates with my friend Klein. It is a cluster of class fractions within that part of the upper half of the socioeconomic US pyramid, which is allied with the new economic and technological sectors of tertiary or service industry, including media and education, and employed women, as well as university and high school students. So it is a cluster of fractions, I believe, whose peculiar in-between social position between the upper and the lower classes is the basis of the rapid ideological shifts in science fiction. Most clearly, the sudden turn from the radical rebelliousness of the writers, say, between 1961 and 74, to the conformism and privatization after the mid-70s. I'm speaking statistically here, I'm not speaking about exceptions, okay? Characteristically, this has been accompanied by the retreat of many writers from the more sophisticated SF readership to a bid for Hollywood film rights and the minimum common denominator of bestseller readership, as well as to a blurring of the lines towards heroic and horror fantasy. Both of these orientations are strongly counterproductive as regards SF quality. And I wish to finish by speaking a little bit about fantasy, which of course has supplanted science fiction in the interest of the readers in the last 30, 40 years. It is based on what? First, on this has resulted in the rise of the precariate new class. If you wish, you could call it precarious proletariate, I don't know. The fitfully employed or largely unemployed people, by now probably a majority in the younger readers and some ethnic groups such as the blacks and Chicanos. Science fiction appealed to social groups with confidence that something can be done about a collective historical future, if only as terrible warnings. So that they were in a comfortable neighborliness towards and mostly actual alliance with techno-science. To the contrary, in a situation where people's entire life world has in the meanwhile undergone much further capillary colonization, the appeal of fantasy is to uncertain social classes or fractions who have been cast adrift and lost that confidence, so that they face their own present and future either with horror, that's the horror fantasy, or with the resolve to have a good time before the deluge, that's the heroic fantasy, or both together if you can mix them. The long-range structural crisis of capitalism coincided with the mass growth of fantastic fiction in and at the end of the high modernist phase. You will remember that its readership started with disaffected intellectuals from Edgar Allan Poe to William Morris. It then burgeoned into a mass appeal to the marginalized social groups. In particular, this includes a large segment of the young generation whom the collapse of the welfare state and all other organized opposition to savage capitalism has left without economic and ideological anchorage. The hugely encroaching commodification of everything means that when work is obtained, it's very rarely related to pleasure anymore. I hope you here are exceptions. Subjectivity has been bereft of most private oases, the work and the family, which used to alleviate subjection and marginalization. This results in a huge rise of everyday humiliations in shamelessly exploited labor, sexism, racism, and finally a scores of extremely dirty wars, instituting global surveillance and reducing people to data murdering or being murdered while carefully occulting the reasons. One resentful response is then a hugely swelling yearning for a world where goods are not commodities and people are not alienated by the pervasive machinery of bourgeois war of each against each, or at least where the leader's representative is top dog, Conan, Aragorn, whatever. In them, the sympathetic heroes are often pirates or thieves or swordsmen or average people faced with inexplicable opportunities or resentfully yoked overwhelming horrors. There seems to be wide agreement that fantasies read predominantly by younger people, perhaps up to their mid-30s and 70% male, who have internalized the experience of lacking safe and permanent employment. A number of them are university graduates, but in post-Fordism, this no longer ensures entry into the professional managerial class. And the numbers seem to be already the de-schooled generation. Certainly, the quality of their education is markedly inferior, especially in science subjects, to the pre-1970s. Therefore, the epistemology of science fiction could appeal to the cognitive universalism of natural or social laws, however renewed in fiction, while an individualistic and pluralist epistemology of fantasy appeals to occultism, whimsy, or magic, opposing the science fiction model while leaning on it. Simultaneously with the symptomatic interest of anthropology for what Levi-Strauss called the societies without history, that is, a short-circuiting of myth and mind outside of history, the young people of the urban middle classes, mostly employees and university educated, rejected the accepted cause and effect relations, or indeed any cause and effect relations. Researchers have noted how exactly parallel in time, at largely overlapping in horizons, are the rise of occultism and the new developments in what is by now all called speculative fiction, that is to say, the science fiction after Dune and all fantasy. The enabling conditions for this are first the decompositions of the political horizons of the 60s counterculture, or any other oppositional mass politics, and the privatization of organizing belief, and second, the tremendous loss of prestige by technoscience because of wars and ecological disasters. In these traits, and I shall finish with this, science fiction has to my mind apparently three, but in fact only two sustainable options. The first option is to continue what a critic has called futuristic costume dramas or space operas, erasing more and more the difference with fantasy as to any rational credibility involved. The best writer of this option is surely, after Dahlgren, Samuel Delaney. The second option is to defiantly embrace the NASA use of hard sciences as the only rightful claim to science fiction. Let me call it the Ben Bova School by the name of a famous editor. This is going to become not perhaps commercially extinct, as some critics prophesy, but it's going to become the fiction of those engineering and science students who still read fiction, which is a dwindling group. For the genre as a whole, it is no option. The third option, and the only one to hold some hopes for the flourishing of a thoughtful science fiction, is what I would, lacking a proper name, tentatively call the Le Guin to K.S. Robinson line, if you know these two writers. Kim Stanley Robinson.